This is my introduction to the identity movement. We have some amazing presentations coming up tonight. First and foremost, it'll be Joshua presenting the basics of a shortwave radio.
Thanks, Kara.
Shortwave radio. At our last go share, we had a first responder who came in and gave us an overview on the different types of radios that we have the ability to use when a disaster strikes. And a shortwave radio was something that I was then talking to my father-in-law about afterwards, telling him about the Skillshare that we went over, and he's like, hold on a second. And he went into his closet and pulled out this shortwave radio that he had. And he let me borrow it, and I got to take it home and figure out how it works and like do some research on like what shortwave radios are for. And I then jotted down all that information, organized it into a presentation, and now I'm going to share it with you guys. So, why a shortwave radio? Well, this little guy is a method of receiving communications during and after a disaster strike. Think about a potential hurricane, cell phone towers getting knocked down. How would you really communicate with each other if your cell phones didn't work any longer? Imagine being in that hurricane wake of the town's really trashed and you don't know what's happening on the few streets down the road. You don't know what's happening in the next town over. You don't know if any disaster aid is coming. So these are really serious questions when you are feeling all alone and isolated from the world. We're so used to being connected 24/7 with cell phones that I think it would be a moment of panic to realize, like, I can't communicate with anybody. Worst case scenario is electromagnetic pulse. Last week, we had a solar flare shoot off the sun off the right side, and it would have been a kill shot if it was aimed at Earth. It hit Mercury and Mars. And if it would just happen to fire off about 2 days prior, it would have been pointed right at us, and it would most likely have knocked out the electrical grids. So an electromagnetic pulse, with an electromagnetic pulse, wiping out the electricity and the solar flares or and the electrical grid. If you happen to have your shortwave radio in a Faraday cage, it would have survived the electromagnetic pulse, and meanwhile, everything else just wouldn't turn on. And imagine that scenario where just going through your day, everything's fine, and then all the electronics stop working. You don't even like see anything take place. Everything just like dies. Kind of a panic. Yeah. But with the shortwave radio, you would be able to get news from halfway across the world with this little guy. That's what's so great about this. So, shortwave radio, it has frequencies from 1.6 to 30 megahertz. To think of the AM radio stations that we're familiar with, those are 531 kilohertz to 1710, so you can, on your dial, you'll be able to go from that. Then the shortwave radios are between the AM stations and the FM stations. There's a wide spectrum of space in between those. They go from 3700 hertz to 26,000 hertz, so there's like a ton of room in between those. FM radio stations, they only can do straight lines of communication. So there's relay stations, and that's why we can get like Seattle radio stations all the way up here, because it relays in a straight line. But the shortwave radio, it bounces off the ionosphere, so that's why we can like get stuff from around the world all the way into those like middle frequency bands. Some of those stations that we can pick up are government propaganda. The government is constantly just putting out information. Take what you want from that. Or oceanic air traffic control. Learn about weather. There's aircraft, weather, and boat utility stations. So good if they're just pumping out data about wind and storms. And also my favorite, there's pirate radio in these stations. And apparently, I've never heard one yet, but on like holidays and like special events, these just pirate radio stations will pop up and they can say whatever they want, uncensored, because there's no way to pinpoint their locations.
So is that almost like the equivalent of like a hacker in the radio station?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. Interesting.
So it's like underground.
Yeah, so it's relatively easy to like set up these broadcasting stations, depending on their like how much power you have access to. But you can like broadcast whatever type of information you want on these channels. Pretty cool to think about. Some of the influencers on the strength of the signal includes the time of the day. At nighttime, what I came to find out was, when I was like searching through those middle bands, it was just scanning right through, not picking up anything. But then I tried it at night, and I was starting to get some like faint signals where it was catching these channels. And it has to do with our magnetosphere and like the tail of the sun over here. There's like more room for signals to circulate in the darkness. Mm-hmm. So seasons, because of that darkness, you have a like wider window of availability. And then also solar flares. Solar flares can create radio blackouts, and these happen quite frequently whenever we get any solar activity aimed at us. There'll just be a blackout section on the planet where nothing is getting through.
So if we were to have a solar flare, would that mean that all of our electronics that were not shielded would be permanently destroyed?
It would have to be a really big solar flare. Like the one that fired off, there was one that made the news, and that was directed at Earth, and that was like the 14th biggest solar flare that had ever been pointed at us on record. But that wasn't as big as the one that shot off the side and would have definitely been like a kill shot.
And that means that completely kills all like many electronics in their entire life, and they won't be useful ever again.
It would have been EMP pulse. Yeah. There's parts that you can replace and get them up and rolling again, but yeah, for the most part. And everything below that kill shot still are these charged particles coming out from the sun that interact with our environment and make an effect here on the planet. So they can cause those radio blackouts in smaller degrees.
Did you happen to come across one of like a Faraday cage just made out of?
Yeah, and I would love to be able to go over that in an upcoming Skillshare, because there's all sorts of different designs, but it can be as simple as like an old microwave and put electronics inside there and just like leave it in there and forget about it, and that shielding will not allow those dangerous charged particles in. Mm-hmm. Another one is an RV, big ass metal box. Okay. Yeah.
Does the type of metal have anything to do
with it? Yes, conductiveness, I would imagine. But those surprised me when I heard it. Like, oh man, it's just natural Faraday cages. Like big metal garages, they can act as some too. But more specifically, I think I want to like get into some wire frame Faraday cages that like we can make for ourselves, and it would not hurt to have one in your garage and put some shortwave radio in there, because if and when that day comes, like you got something working in there. So some advantages of shortwave radios are the difficulty of censoring, as we kind of talked about with IF radio. That's a very fun thought to think about. Low cost. I think this one is like on eBay for less than $100. And this antenna has the ability to be amplified. I saw a diagram of like hooking it up to cord and making the cord much longer, like out in, up and around your room. And I think that would greatly make it the strength longer, because even at night, like I said, I was just barely picking up some inaudible channels. So I do want to play around with this some more. The widespread use, there's 1.5 billion shortwave radios like on the planet.
Wow.
So in a disaster, people are definitely going to be using these as a form of communication, and it could be life-saving. It travels farther than FM radio, like I said, and it's a very robust system. You can make your own, just involving two transceivers, an antenna, and a battery. So it's just something, if you know what you're doing, MacGyver style, you can like create a shortwave radio. Some of the disadvantages, as I was experiencing, is it picks up local noise, which means computers that can be on, fluorescent lights, and dimmer switches, it'll pick up that noise, and you'll have to like,
how does that work?
It's just
static.
Yeah. Weird. So I went outside at night to get a like cleaner signal. So this is a shortwave radio. There's really nothing exciting. I don't think I can show you with it right now, just because it's daytime and nothing outside of AM, FM that you guys are already familiar with worth checking out. But I do plan on tinkering around with this more and trying to get a stronger signal to really get some good data in case we need it.
I'm guessing it takes batteries.
Yeah, takes batteries. There's a world clock on it. And yeah, any other questions?
Just one. Do you know if there's any truth to the aluminum foil jersey?
Amplified?
Yeah,
for sure. Okay. For sure it does. I was seeing some diagrams. It was using some like metal cord around the antenna, and then like hooked up to your like window curtain, and like looped back around. But I would be using aluminum foil to like reinforce that circuit.
Do you know what you need to broadcast?
No, that would be an excellent thing to look into.
Wait, what?
Well, this is like a one-way radio where you're just receiving communications.
You just listen.
So yeah, to create your own broadcasting station, I bet you can Google it.